Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. A small announcement before we start our session today. Target prelims second document has been uploaded on our website and also pinned in yesterday's CNA video. You can download them and practice the questions which are very beneficial for your upcoming preliminary examination. So let's get started and look into the first article. The first article says, after Supreme Court rap, EC wakes up to its powers. What is this article? This article and its relevance has all been explained under the first topic that we discussed in yesterday's video. So kindly look into it for the explanation. However, what this article speaks about, it gives us certain laws which can be important when we are writing our answers. So what are these? These are the laws which will help in tackling the hate speech. So the laws that it speaks about are in reference to the Indian Penal Code of 1860, where section 124A of the IPC penalizes the sedition, which we have already discussed. So what this sedition is already mentioned in our YouTube video, so kindly look into it. Then there is section 153A of the IPC, which penalizes promotion of enmity between different groups on the grounds of religion, race, place of birth, residence, language, etc., and acts prejudicial to the harmony in the society. This is the law which can be taken up by the Election Commission, which can be enforced in terms of such a violation. Then we also have the Representation of the People's Act of 1951, which says that section 123(3)(a) and section 125 prohibits promotion of enmity on the grounds of religion, race, caste, community or language in connection with election as a corrupt electoral practices and prohibits it. Then we have the Cable Television Network Regulation Act of 1995. In this law, section 5 and 6 of the act prohibit transmission or retransmission of a program through the cable network in contravention to the prescribed program code or the advertisement code. Then finally, what we have is the Cinematography Act of 1952. Sections 4, 5B and 7 empower the Board of Film Certification to prohibit and regulate the screening of a film. And this is in reference to the movie that was supposed to be released on Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So these are the various laws which the Election Commission of India would be able to take up and enforce in case there is any violation with reference to the Model Code of Conduct. So this is all we have to know in reference to this article. Rest of the issues we have explained in our yesterday CNA video. So kindly look into it for the same. So let's move into the next article. This article says, Vellore poll cancelled over cash seizures. Let's look into the context. During elections, it is an undeniable fact that financial superiority translates into electoral advantage. So, richer candidates and parties who have lot of money power have a greater chance of winning elections. So, this has to be looked into. And two important institutes, the Election Commission of India and the Supreme Court, looks into the electoral expenses of a person as well as the party. The Supreme Court in Kanwarlal Gupta versus Amarnath Chawla has given a beautiful articulation of the money power. It says money is bound to play an important part in the successful prosecution of an election campaign. Money supplies assets for advertising and other forms of political solicitation that increases the candidate's exposure to the public. Not only can money buy advertising and canvassing facilities such as hoardings, posters, handbills, brochures, etc., and all other paraphernalia of an election campaign. So what is this? It means that this money would be able to buy every other miscellaneous items that is required for the election campaigning. But it can also provide the means for quick and speedy communication and movements and sophisticated campaign techniques, and is also a substitute for energy in that paid workers can be employed where volunteers are found to be insufficient. The availability of large funds does ordinarily tend to increase the number of votes a candidate will receive. If therefore one political party or individual has large resources available to it, than another individual or political party. The former would certainly, under the present system of conducting elections, have an advantage over the latter in the electoral process. In order to make sure that everyone has a level playing field, the Election Commission of India has also come up with certain laws which we have to understand. So what are these laws? The Election Commission of India, under this particular constitutional mandate given to it, has also come up with certain laws which limit the electoral expenditure for contesting candidates. This has been set up in the Section 77 of the Representation of the People's Act as well as the Election Rules of 1961. So Section 77 of the Representation of the People's Act limits the electoral spending by that particular person, and Conduct of Election Rules of 2014 also prescribes the amount that can be spent. So these rules says that between 54 to 70 lakhs can be spent by a candidate for the parliamentary constituencies. Further lays out that 20 to 28 lakhs can be spent for the assembly constituencies. In case there is a person who goes on to spend beyond this, then Election Commission of India pictures in and can take legal provisions as well. Now the question is, in case there is a person who has enough money and in case there is a corporation which can fund elections, why is that the Election Commission of India is obstructing it or stopping it? This becomes the background as to why the Election Commission of India is stopping and has laid a limit for spending for a candidate. Let's look into what could be the implications because of this. Unregulated or underregulated election financing leads to two types of capturing. So what are these two types of capturing? One, in case there is a person who is contributing or there is a corporation which is contributing for a person or for a political party, what it means is that the industry or that particular private entity or that particular individual will use all their money to ensure that there are less stringent regulations, and the money that can be used to finance all these elections will eventually lead to favorable policies. So what these corporations or individuals and entities are doing is they'll fund these individuals or the political parties, and these political parties will come up with favorable laws which is appeasing that particular corporation. Then there are certain number of legislations which are also brought in so that particular law favors a particular organization. And then there is crony capitalism. There are n number of contracts and projects within the government. These are not going by the bidding process, but instead are directly delivered to that particular organization which has initially funded. So what should have been on a transparent process has currently become opaque, and what should have been a law based on public interest and universal interest, this has been subjugated under the guise of the corporations, under the guise of the money that has been spent by the individual. Another important capture is in reference to the people themselves. So what happens is, when there is disproportionate and self-serving influence, corporations capture not just the regulators, but they also capture the views of the ordinary citizens, which they tend to showcase it as public interest. So on one side, it is capturing the government. On the other side, it tends to showcase certain policies that this is very important for public interest. This might not be important for public interest, but they are capturing all these entities in such a way that they are telecasting, projecting these entities or their programs as something which is appealing or something which is important for public interest. Let's take a simple example. Let's say there is a particular land, and in this particular land, there is extraction of water that is happening in this area. Let's go back to Coca-Cola case that happened in Kerala. So there is establishment of a particular company. So this particular company extracts groundwater from this particular area in Palakkad, which is called as Coca-Cola case. So there is employment provision. There is number of developmental infrastructure projects. But ultimately, when you look at it, people are shown that this is a very important project. This is a mind-blowing project where employment is provided, infrastructure development is happening. But ultimately, what the people fail to realize is that this company started sucking up a lot of groundwater, and all the water that was required for the agriculture was not provided. So water being an important fundamental asset which is required for the existence of human was completely sucked up. And what we see is, in the guise of public interest, these companies came up, but ultimately the sufferers are the environment and the people themselves. So in order to avoid all this, that is why the Election Commission of India pictures in. And when this pictures in, it lays out a foundation and a universal law which could make sure that there is level playing field. So now that we have understood what the implications are, let's try and understand what are the penalizing provisions. The penalizing provisions as espoused are the incurring or the authorizing expenditure in violation of section 77 amounts to corrupt practice under section 123 of 6 of the RPA and can result in disqualification for a maximum period of 6 years both as a candidate and a voter under sections 8A as well as 11A. Section 10A further says, additionally provides for disqualification for failure to lodge accounts of election expenses. So this is what we need to understand in reference to this article. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article here is completely a biased view of a particular political party. So let's not look into the political aspects that have been discussed, but only focus at some of the administrative aspects that we can draw from this article. Let's understand the essential meaning of democracy. Democracy is the basic feature of the Constitution. An election conducted at regular prescribed intervals is essential to democratic system that is envisaged in the Constitution. Let's go back to the Bommai case. In the Bommai case, the Supreme Court observed that democracy and federalism are essential features of our Constitution and are part of the basic structure. Therefore, it is mandatory for India to conduct timely elections. Currently, when you look at the countries elsewhere, democracy has become a myth. The transparency which is expected has turned into a cloud of opaqueness. Rules are tweaked, orders brought with complete concentration of power in the hands of the few, and democracy is bent to the whims of the executive. This is seen in countries like Brazil, Philippines, Turkey, Russia, and we also know for the fact that is in the People's Republic of China. But India is the shining light in the world which is espousing stronger values of democracy due to strong constitution, institution and independent judiciary. Now let's go back to the core values of our constitution. Gandhi as well as Jawaharlal Nehru had proposed social justice and grassroots democracy. On this particular basis, we have core ideas of those people implemented in the directive principles of state policy and in the form of 73rd and the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act. Then we have India's parliamentary democracy, which has been an example for many of the South Asian countries as well. We have number of institutions like the Indian Supreme Court, which is acting as a jurisprudence study elsewhere. And there are examples of civil service which has been taken as a case studies for many other countries. And India has also set an example of aspirational welfare state. So what this article speaks about in nutshell is that it says that there is more concentration of power in few hands. It can impact the institutions. So there needs to be more devolution of power as espoused by Gandhi as well as Nehru. And this is the way to go, is what this article all about. Rest of the things in this particular article seems to be a political one. That is the prime reason we're not going to discuss this. But the essence of this article is more the concentration of power in few hands. There will be disaster for the institutions. So this will have to be removed. And at the same time, more powers will also have to be segmented through the lower layers of governance. So this is what we need to understand in reference to this article. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article here is speaking about Indonesian elections. Indonesia has presidential form of elections. Here, president is elected for a term of about 5 years, and this is conducted by the Independent Election Commission, which is called as the General Election Commission. What this article says is that there are two people in the fray. They are into the electoral computation. So who are those? We have the incumbent president, and that is Joko Widodo of the Indonesian Democratic Party of Struggle, and his challenger would be Prabowo Subianto. So what this article speaks about is these two people have different ways of governance. Let's understand some of the important factual data with respect to the Jokowi. So what Jokowi stands for is in reference to pro-China. So he is a pro-Chinese person, and all his governance model runs in supporting the Chinese model of implementation. So he has pledged support for the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and a vocal supporter of One Belt, One Road initiative. So what this article suggests is that Jokowi has been one of those presidents who has been supportive of the Chinese model of investment and infrastructure. So he wants Indonesia to be developed by investments that have been garnered from China. At the same time, there is this person who is also contesting against him, and that is Subianto. Subianto presents himself as a nationalist. He emphasizes on security, balanced foreign policy, more local manufacturing, and a just social order. When it comes to Jokowi, he was pro-China. But when it comes to Subianto, he has more open relationship partnership apart from China. So who will be winning these elections, and what will be the policies of them? What are its economics advantages? What is their international diplomatic mode of operation? Will all be discussed after the elections. But as of now, this is all we have to understand. But now let's understand some of the key facts which are important for your preliminary examination. The first key important fact is about Samudra Maitri. This is a relief effort launched by India to assist the victims of 2018 Sulawesi earthquake and tsunami in Indonesia. Kindly remember, Samudra Maitri is an effort by India to assist Indonesia after the earthquake as well as tsunami. Then we also have Samudra Shakti, which is a naval exercise between Indonesia and India. The aim of the exercise is to strengthen bilateral relations, expand maritime cooperation, enhance interoperability, and exchange best practices. Further, there is a port which India is developing, and that is the Sabang port. So kindly remember, India is developing a maiden deep sea port in Indonesia, and that happens to be Sabang port. And also remember its geographical location being close to the strategic Strait of Malacca. Another important prelims fact is about the Natuna Island. Natuna Island is part of Indonesia, but what we see is certain dominance that has been played by China. China wakes up every single morning and it dreams that it owns the world. So one such dream is with reference to the 9-dash line. So China believes, according to its historical data, there is something called as 9-dash line, and according to this 9-dash line, Natuna Islands also belongs to it. But unfortunately, this is not the reality according to the modern geographic standards. So this Natuna Island belongs to the Indonesia. This can also be likely asked. So kindly remember this. This can also be asked that Natuna Island is a conflict between which two countries? It is between Indonesia and China. And the other important factors that Natuna Island is part of Indonesia itself. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article here says lakes are filled with liquid methane on Titan. So let's look into some of the facts with respect to Titan. Titan is the largest moon of Saturn and second largest natural satellite in the solar system. It is the second largest moon in solar system after Jupiter's moon Ganymede. It is the only moon in the solar system known to have clouds and dense atmosphere. It is larger than the planet Mercury and more massive than Pluto, and in significant ways it resembles a planet. Hence, it is also frequently described as planet-like moon. Titan is the most Earth-like body in the solar system. It has lakes, canyons, rivers, dunes, fields of organic sand particles about same size as silica sand grains on Earth. What is the present context? So when we look into the present context, it says that there was one of the mission by the NASA's Cassini spacecraft where it has identified certain lakes which is filled with liquid methane. Now let's look into the detail aspect. Earth has a lot of liquid on its surface, but the same can't be expected from many other worlds in our solar system. But Titan is an exception. It has vast swathes of lake visible from the space. The lakes which are present in this particular Titan is not actually water, but because there is presence of extreme cold temperature, the presence of methane, which is a gas in Earth, is acting as a liquid in Titan. So currently what we have to understand is there is presence of H2O or water which is acting as liquid in Earth. But because of extremes of temperature, this methane, which is a gas in Earth, is acting as a liquid in Titan. So what we have to understand here is that Titan's liquid is methane and ethane instead of water. This article further mentions about Ligelia Mare. This Ligelia Mare is a lake in the North Polar region of Titan. It is the second largest body of liquid on the surface of the Titan, the first one being Kraken Mare. So this is another important factual data that we have to understand. This article further speaks about a concept called as phantom lakes. What is phantom lakes here? This is nothing but the hydrological cycle that happens in the Titan. So what basically is this phantom lakes? So according to scientists, they describe certain characteristics as a phantom lake. There is presence of liquid during the winter. But what we have to realize is that this liquid that is present in the winter evaporates or gets completely drained up in the springtime. So when there is presence of liquid in the winter but no liquid in the springtime, this particular concept is what is called as the phantom lakes, which is a hydrological cycle like we have in the Earth's water cycle. So this is what we need to understand in reference to this article. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article here is speaking about the Pyrenees Mountain. So the Pyrenees Mountain is a range of mountain in the southwestern part of the Europe. This forms as a natural border between Spain as well as France. So kindly remember that Pyrenees act as a natural barrier or a differentiation between Spain as well as France. The range here separates also the Iberian Peninsula from the rest of the continental Europe. So this is the Iberian Peninsula. So this separates the rest of the continental Europe. But why are we discussing about this mountain? So when we look into the context, scientists have found that this secluded region in the Pyrenees Mountains, previously considered as pristine, that is that particular region which was undisturbed, that which has a natural virgin vegetation, that which is not interfered by the humans, so it was pristine in nature, is now covered with microplastics. So what do these scientists say? Because of the wind, because of moving of wind from one region to another region, it has also carried plastics, and these plastics are now deposited in the pristine landform of the Pyrene. So this is what we need to understand in reference to this article. So moving on, let's look into the practice questions. Consider the following statements regarding Advocate General of a state. The Advocate General of a state must be qualified to be appointed as a judge of a high court. Constitution specifies the age of Advocate General to be not more than 65 years. Which of the above statements is correct? The answer for this is only one. Why? Because the Constitution does not specify any age limit whatsoever. Moving on, let's look into the next practice question. The Gulf of Siam shares coastline with which of the following countries? Japan, South Korea, Cambodia, and Russia. And the answer for this is 3 only. Why? Let's look into the map. The Gulf of Thailand is formally called as the Gulf of Siam. This is an inlet of South China Sea which borders Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam as well. So what we need to understand is from that particular question, it borders only Cambodia and not any other country. Why have we picked this up? Because this article mentions about Gulf of Thailand. Moving on, let's look into the next practice question. Consider the following statements. The Parliamentary Committee on Public Accounts consists of not more than 25 members of the Lok Sabha, scrutinizes appropriation and finance accounts of the government, examines the report of Comptroller and Auditor General of India. Which of the statements given above is correct? The answer for this is 2 and 3 only. Why? Because the first one is wrong because it consists of only 22 members and not 25 members. So this is it for today. Thank you for watching. All the best.